Working for a Cause, Using Your Social Media Savvy to Make a Difference, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Julie Dixon, Deputy Director of the Georgetown University Center for Social Impact Communication in the School of Continuing Studies. Before we begin, I'd just like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and you can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services, or you can use the link that I just sent out to everyone in the chat box on your GoTo control panel. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial in to the conference bridge number provided. You are not required to have a headset, but are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening through your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type your questions into the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen, and Julie is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion at the end of the presentation. And afterwards, I will email everyone a copy of her slides. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. And without further ado, I'd like to tell you a bit more about our presenter. Julie Dixon investigates the changing ways we interact with and support the significant social issues facing the world today. As Deputy Director of Georgetown University Center for Social Impact Communication, she is responsible for managing its operations and growing its reputation as a leader in educating and inspiring responsible communicators. Through her research and teaching, Julie works with hundreds of organizations annually, equipping them to more effectively engage people in their work and share the compelling stories of their impact. She focuses much of her energy on promoting the role of technology in building connections and advancing solutions. So Julie, I'm so glad you were able to join us today. Obviously, this is something that I believe is near and dear to many of our Georgetown alums who are working to promote social causes. So I will now turn it over to you. Thanks for being here.
Great. Thank you so much, Sarah. I'm so excited to be here today to hopefully have a conversation with all of you about some of the research that we've been doing lately at the Center for Social Impact Communication and how you can really use these insights to help drive results for the causes that you may work for or, you know, those that you may just care about in your day-to-day personal life. I've got tons of examples of campaigns and tactics that have worked for different organizations, as well as some suggestions on how you can incorporate these tactics into your own approach to using social media to ultimately make a difference in whatever context that may be. Before we dive in, I just want to give a quick overview of the center, since many of you on the call today may be unfamiliar with who we are and what we do here at Georgetown. The center has been in existence for just over 5 years. And we're a part of the Graduate Division of Professional Communication within the university, which includes the master's programs in both public relations and corporate communications, as well as in journalism. And we're really the only academic initiative of our kind in the country, and we're quite proud to say that, in that we focus not just on nonprofit management or on corporate social responsibility or social enterprise in general, but we really look specifically at the role that communication and communicators can play in fostering engagement and social change across each of those different areas, as well as the interplay between those areas. So we work to really define what it means to be a responsible communicator in today's society with all the tools at our disposal, and to help shape that conversation about how to communicate about impact in a way that is authentic, that's transparent, and that's ultimately engaging. And as Sarah mentioned, we work with hundreds of organizations year in and year out to help improve the way they communicate with stakeholders online and offline and everything in between. And in turn, the challenges that we see them facing, you know, on a day-to-day basis really helps inform our research and the work that we do and how we think about these topics. So with that, I want to dive right into our discussion now. So this is probably not the first thing that you expect to see on a webinar that basically promotes the idea that social media can make a difference for causes. But I wanted to provide some of the broader context and some alternate opinions, maybe play devil's advocate for a moment. You know, these opinions that exist within the realm of what we call social media for social good. So this particular campaign was launched back in the spring by UNICEF Sweden. And it's essentially telling its supporters, you know, forget about liking us or supporting us online. What we want is your donations. So the funny thing and the ironic thing about this campaign was that it was designed to be shared on social media with these, you know, shareable images, and there were some accompanying videos. You know, if you Google the campaign, you'll see there's a funny series of videos where a stand-up comedian in Sweden tries to barter for a sweater, and he tries to pay for a meal in a restaurant with likes. They're actually quite funny. But they're designed to be engaging and to be passed around. So on some level, UNICEF Sweden, whether they wanted to acknowledge it or not in the messaging, they actually understand the value of generating conversation and getting people to share your organization's point of view with their friends. And they certainly got people talking, you know, for sure with this campaign. And they're not alone. Other high-profile organizations recently have taken a similar stance, emphasizing financial donations and really trying to minimize the perception that a like on Facebook or some other kind of support on social media has any kind of an impact for the organization. And it's not just nonprofits like UNICEF. We've actually seen in our own research that individuals themselves can often question the value of supporting a cause online through social media. So these are a couple of statements that we included in a survey of the American public that we did a couple of years ago and asked them whether or not they agreed or disagreed with them. So I'm going to give you a second to kind of mull over these statements and see how you feel about them, and then I'll show you what the population as a whole thought. So, you know, emails can sometimes feel like spam. Everybody likes causes on Facebook, but it doesn't really, you know, mean anything at the end of the day. And just this overwhelming sense of, I get too many emails and messages about causes today. And as you can see, there's some pretty pessimistic numbers here. Now, granted, this study is a couple of years old, and since then we've seen some, you know, pretty high-profile examples of campaigns and organizations like CONI 2012 or the Susan G. Komen Planned Parenthood incident that have attracted a lot of attention for their use of social media and for their ability to perhaps start to translate that action and that conversation to activities that actually have an impact. But I think there's still some healthy skepticism among people who think that, you know, their clicks and the likes and the shares, you know, actually do or don't add up to something meaningful, especially when organizations themselves, you know, like UNICEF and some of the other ones, are out there telling them that they don't matter. So really what we're addressing and coming up against is this idea or this perception that these online actions are inconsequential and that the people who choose to partake in them are what we call slacktivists. It's a very frightening term. They are lazy, they're selfish, or they just don't understand the difference between liking something on Facebook and, you know, and making a donation in terms of the impact that those different actions will have. And in many ways, I think that this is an unfair categorization because, as we've seen in our research, the people who are out there supporting causes on social media are usually doing that in addition to other things. They are donating, they are volunteering, and in addition to that, they're talking about it on social media, which is a great, really powerful thing. There are, you know, other terms for slacktivists that have popped up lately. Clicktivists, you might see that occasionally, and even within the last year, you've seen the term picktivism or picktivists popping up. A good example of these so-called picktivists is the human rights campaign that, you know, many of you may be familiar with from last spring, where the organization encouraged people to change their Facebook pictures to show support for marriage equality. This was last March, I believe. And so, yes, changing your Facebook picture, your profile picture, is a relatively easy action for people to take. But the results in this case were really interesting. Facebook was able to calculate that on a single day, you know, shortly after the campaign launched, by their estimates, 2.7 million more people changed their profile picture that day than normal. It was something like 120% more than a typical day for that particular day of the week. And they could even break it down by age and by geography. And they were able to estimate that, you know, looking at your the whole pool of 30-year-old Facebook users, 3.5% of them actually changed their profile pictures in response to this campaign. So if you think back to that week in March, I'm sure many of you probably saw this sea of various, you know, versions of this red icon in your news feed, and collectively, it was some really pretty powerful visual proof, or social proof, if you will, of the support that existed for the issue of marriage equality. And that's the kind of thing that can raise awareness and ultimately lead to behavior change and people taking action. So all of that stems from, a so-called pictivist. So what I want to do is share with you some of our most recent findings and some of the research that we've done on why and how people interact with causes today using social media to kind of lay the groundwork for some examples and tips on how you can do it effectively and successfully, both as as an organization and then perhaps as an individual if you want to kind of start your own campaign. So the first big idea is that when it comes to people supporting causes, it comes down to personal connections. People support causes that have impacted themselves or someone they know, or that are important to themselves or to someone they know. So they're far more likely to support a cause if a friend asks them to, or if a friend tells a story or explains why it's important to them. Interestingly, it's also been proven in other research that people are far more likely to support the plight of an individual as opposed to a whole group. So if you were to say, give $10 to support millions of people around the world who live in poverty, that's much less effective than saying, this specific person right here will benefit from your $10 donation. It's because we like to have a human face, a human connection when we're interacting with causes. And a great example of this is of just how important that this friend connection can be are a lot of the crowdfunding campaigns that have popped up recently. And this one in particular was launched right after the Boston Marathon bombings, and it was one of many, asking people to give an amount of money to support people who were injured that day and, facing a real uphill battle on their road to recovery. So this particular campaign was to support a husband and wife who were both injured that day. Both ended up having to have one of their legs amputated and obviously, face all kinds of financial burdens and prosthetics and medical care and home modifications. So this campaign was actually started by a friend of theirs from college. And I believe it was started, shortly within a day after the bombing on that Monday. And by that Thursday night, just, 3 days or 2.5 days later, they had already raised more than $300,000. And what's really striking, if you look at the campaign and you look at who donated and their comments, in particular the ones that I highlighted here, these are all people who actually don't know the couple at all. But what's interesting is that they know their friends. You can see if you look through these comments, it's, we know you through our good friends, or we know you through a coworker, or, I don't know you, but a friend shared your story with me. And that's how the information and that's how the ask spread. And I think that's a really interesting phenomenon that has really come up and really been enabled by technology and being able to spread these ideas across social media. So that leads us to our second big idea, which is that people love to talk about the causes they support, and they do this for very specific reasons. We did another study just within the past year in partnership with the PR firm Wagner Edstrom. And one of our key findings was that social media is now actually the number one way that people find out about causes. And the really interesting piece is that this is true whether you actually support the causes online and through social media, and it's also true for people who only support causes offline. So it really reinforces this idea that your Facebook newsfeed is today's Yellow Pages or, today's website. It used to be that you had to be in the Yellow Pages to be credible. Or then, there was a period of time where you needed to have a website, you needed to have a web presence to be credible. And now, like it or not, you have to be on Facebook and you have to be in front of people on their news feeds for people to know about you and people to know that you're, a legit cause or campaign. And what's also really interesting is that people's motivations for why they do the types of things that they do to support causes have seemed to shift a little bit with social media as well. It used to be that, you talked about the kinds of causes that you care about with your friends or your family because you wanted them to think that you were generous, or you wanted them to see you as, worldly and knowledgeable about social issues. And these are certainly still true, but the one thing that people want even more is to have an influence over others. They want to convince other people to get on board and to support the causes that they support. And because of this, organizations have really tremendous opportunity to give them the tools and equip them and really encourage them to act on this desire. Here's a great example of this desire to influence in action, so to speak. when an organization like the ASPCA posts content like this, it always gets a ton of shares on social media. You can see that there's almost, 4,000 just on this post alone, which is fantastic because each of those shares is an opportunity to expose individuals in those people's networks to the ASPCA's content. What's really great is when people share it, but they also add their personal story or some kind of statement to encourage their friends to get involved so that, again, you have that personal touch, you have that personal connection rather than just the organization's message. And so finally, what we've really seen is that all of this talking and all of this sharing can, contrary to the perceptions of the Slacktivists that we talked about earlier, thinking that their support ends with that click of a mouse, we've really seen that it can, in fact, lead to concrete, tangible actions. In fact, in the survey that we did earlier this year, more than half of our respondents have gone on to donate or volunteer or get involved in some other way after being involved on social media. And you can see here the breakdown of the kinds of activities that people then pursued. And this is really encouraging for organizations who were thinking that social media was really the final stop in a person's engagement. Instead, it can lead to further engagement, or they could be, donating and volunteering and, participating in other ways and then layering that social media on top of it, which is, again, a fantastic thing and should be encouraged, unlike, some of the UNICEF and other campaigns. So what does this, all of this mean for organizations and people who are trying to really move the needle and get people involved in supporting causes through social media? It's about, I think, harnessing that energy and finding a way to help direct it and encourage people to channel that influence into getting their friends and family on board. And so I have four pieces of advice and examples of things that have worked in this arena. The first is that you really need to build out a credible social media presence. And by credible, I mean one that is visually consistent and integrated with the rest of your communication, one in which you post regularly so that people know what to expect, and one that has content that's appropriate to the particular channel. So you may wonder why I have a picture of the Washington Metro here, but this is actually a great example of something that is very visually consistent. The stations, for the most part, all look the same. They feel the same when you go into them. Because of that, you know what you're getting, and you know where to look to get the information you need. It's not always good information when you find it. There's track work going on or trains are delayed or something, but you know where to find it and you know what to expect. And I think similarly, organizations need to sort of look the part with their social channels. And this is really, it's not that hard of a thing to do anymore. You used to need to know fancy tricks like HTML or CSS or things to customize your Facebook or Twitter page with logos and backgrounds and things, but they've pretty much automated that whole process now. So just make sure that you use the same logos, the same fonts, the same colors, et cetera, that you have the same usernames across your different channels, and that you always link back to your website, and there's that integration piece. There's really great guidance online about what size images to use on the different platforms, and I'll make sure that that link is active in the slides that go out after our call today. The thing is, you don't want to use images that are the wrong size or that are pixelated or cropped strangely. All of these things can really hurt your credibility. And this is key. In our research, we've seen that even among, very digitally savvy folks, there's still a lot of skepticism around nonprofits and being willing to give online when you're not sure if they're going to use your money in the right way or if it's a scam or if you have to give out too much personal information. So the need to maintain that credible appearance is really important to help overcome that hurdle, to help overcome that skepticism. And not only this, we also know that people really look to multiple sources of information. So they'll go to your website, they'll watch your videos on YouTube, they'll look you up on Facebook and Twitter, they'll do their due diligence and really scope you out across all the different channels. And if all of these things aren't aligned and consistent with one another, they'll start to get skeptical and you may miss out on opportunities to engage them. So also on the subject of images and visuals and how that can help boost your profile's credibility, you want to make sure that you're also maximizing the opportunities that are presented by this continuing evolution of each of these platforms. Facebook and Twitter have both become much, much more visual now than they were in the past. And newer platforms like Pinterest and Instagram are almost entirely visual. So you want to make sure that you make the most of that real estate and use your images wisely. You can see here how Facebook has changed its layout to really highlight images more within the past year or so. And looking ahead, more changes are coming to highlight that visual content even more. So now you see, you know, when an individual likes your organization on Facebook now, they're going to see, you know, your cover image and whatever you have is that profile image. It's really going to be front and center, whether you're on a computer or whether you're on your mobile phone. It's going to be pretty consistent across both platforms. So, you know, seize those opportunities to really have a strong visual presence. So as much of it is as a pain to kind of keep up with those changes every 6 months or so, it's really about taking advantage of the opportunities and features that, you know, they're naturally embedding into it so that you maintain that fresh, credible look and feel. And there's nothing worse than looking at an organization's Facebook or Twitter page that clearly hasn't been updated since before the layout changed, and they're missing a cover photo at the top, and the logo is the wrong size, and it's cut off, so you can't even see what the organization's full name is. I also mentioned a few slides ago this need to establish a consistent posting schedule as a way to continue to build that credibility. And this means different things to different organizations, for sure, and there are different expectations for your users around how frequently they expect to hear from you on any given social media platform. For example, it's perfectly acceptable to post on Facebook once a day or once every few days, but people expect much more frequent updates on a medium like Twitter. So my advice for organizations is always to find the frequency that works for you so that, again, no matter what that is, people know what to expect from you. If you post once a week, fine. People will see and they'll pick up on that pattern and they'll know that you haven't just stopped updating altogether. Again, it's about, you know, reinforcing that credibility so that people know that you're an organization that's got its act together and that, you know, somebody who you'll want to engage with because it's somebody who can get results and have that impact. So my second piece of advice centers around the content that you post on each channel. So you want to make sure that you're posting content, again, that's shareable, that people want to engage with it, because it's those engagements on those different channels that will trigger the ripple effect of other, of, you know, other people in their network seeing them and consequently, you know, seeing you and wanting to get involved. And so these days, that means visuals, it means infographics, multimedia, memes, which, you know, you always see floating around the internet, and some organizations are really great at, you know, personalizing those and kind of latching on and tying into whatever the meme floating around is, you know, using humor in posts. This is a great statistic that shows just how important visual content is in terms of generating that engagement. You typically see the most comments, the most likes, the most shares on, you know, visual content and images, which translates to the biggest reach for an organization. So that's why so many organizations are really shifting their resources into a content strategy that incorporates heavy use of visuals. And I have a couple examples of organizations that I think really do this well, and one is Georgetown University. I think they do a really fantastic job with this. What I love about their approach is that they use images to showcase different aspects of the mission of the university. You know, they'll give a sense of place and, you know, a sense of nostalgia. You know, remember what campus looked like when you were here, that sort of thing. They celebrate achievements of students and faculty and staff and feature the people that make up the organization. And then they also have fun. And they know that a cute animal picture will always get engagement. So what better than, you know, posting a picture of Jack? So these are all really shareable pieces of content that people want to engage with. And they're also, their social media team is also very smart about adding a watermark so that you know exactly where it came from. So when that does get shared, it's got Georgetown's name all over it. Another really good example of strong content, and again, you know, cute animals. This is the Humane Society, and what I love about this and what I highly recommend is that this image, yes, it features a cute animal, you know, yes, it has a quote, both of which we know are highly engaging and shareable, but it also has a really strong call to action. It's asking people to do something that's pretty simple, you know, signing a pledge, and that allows the organization to capture information from them, their email address, their name, et cetera. and to follow up with other communications. And what's really smart is that they're not asking people to do something really lofty. You know, they're not saying, if you share this image, it will save homeless animals. They're asking them to do a really simple, easy, personal action. People, again, as we've seen, they want to know that they're having an impact, and it's much easier to see this when you say, please share this video with 5 people, and you can say, yep, I shared it with 5 people, rather than, please help us end poverty, which is a much, much harder thing to get people to get behind because they don't know where to start. So the bottom line with content is really that you can and should do some experimentation with posting different types of content and different calls to action to see what resonates the most with your community of supporters. And the good news is it's fairly easy to do this with the analytics that are built into Facebook and to Twitter and to your websites. And one thing that's worth noting is that in our research we asked people why they unfollow or unlike organizations, and what we saw is that it has to do with, you know, the frequency of posting and with the content that just doesn't appeal to them. And these are both things that you can really hone in on your sweet spot just by experimenting and tracking what works over a period of, you know, weeks or months. So my third piece of advice is often one that I think organizations really struggle with the most. And that is letting go of control of messages and letting people create their own content about your organization and encouraging them to share that with their networks. And here's where I really see missed opportunity in the value that people place on their own influence. And this is partly because, you know, as we've seen, organizations never really ask them to use it. In our survey earlier this year, we asked people, what's, you know, the single most important resource that you can give to a cause? And fewer than 1 in 6 said influence. And I think there's tremendous missed opportunity there. If you think about all of the time and the money and the talents and the skills that exist within an individual's network, they're just kind of hanging out there waiting to be asked. But we so often go right to asking people to give money or time. We don't, you know, often ask them to use their influence to get access to all the other resources that exist within that network. And I have a couple examples of organizations that are sort of embracing this idea. And the first one actually comes from outside the cause arena. But it's such a great example of an industry that for so long resisted the idea of change. And so that's the music industry. They've always been notorious for very, very tightly, very carefully guarding their intellectual property, right, their songs. Think back to the days of Napster and Kazaa and all those other file sharing programs and 18-year-old college students getting sued in their dorm rooms for file sharing. What's really interesting is that bands and artists and record labels today are really encouraging their fans to take their songs and record them and make them their own and share them with their friends. You know, even going so far as in this particular example, the band Daughtry had a cover contest and encouraged fans to record a cover, upload it to YouTube, and then have their friends vote on it. And it's really smart because they know that in exchange for, you know, giving away their intellectual property, their songs for free, the trade-off is they're gaining access to, you know, legions of people in these networks that they might not have, you know, had exposure to otherwise. And it really comes back to this idea that, you know, people help their friends. And when a friend tells them a compelling story or shares a piece of content with them, they're more likely to want to get involved than if the organization itself asks them to. A good example of this in the nonprofit arena of an organization that encourages its supporters to create and share content in the form of stories is the ALS Association. And this is a campaign that they launched last May during ALS Awareness Month. So they asked people to send in their stories, either written or videotaped, and they put, you know, a call out on Facebook encouraging people to share, and they had this webpage where they could collect the content. And then they encourage people to engage with those stories and to share them. And so ultimately, and you can see here they sort of track their progress, you know, one week into May, they already had 350 stories that they had collected. And at the end, they ended up with more than 800 that people submitted, which was huge and, you know, way more than their original goal had been. And not only that, they had tons of engagement on the stories. I mean, you can see 123 shares and, you know, 400 some odd likes and, you know, tons of comments. And if you look, they have a a page where they capture, you know, all of the stories, and you can just see some of the engagement figures that are coming back here, you know, hundreds and thousands of shares. And it's a tremendous response from, you know, this very engaged community, and it certainly met their goals of raising awareness for the disease during that month. And they were really smart to focus on stories in particular. As we saw in that survey research that we did earlier this year, the biggest reason that people who made that leap from online support to offline support, thinking back, you know, we had that more than half the population and they go on to donate or volunteer or whatever, the reason that they made that leap from online to off was because they saw a story that made them want to do more. So again, you know, humans connect with stories. It's, you know, the oldest way of sharing information and communicating, and there are, you know, tons of psychological reasons for this. But yeah, the story piece is really key. Another good example of an organization that encourages people to share and to equip their supporters to create and share on their behalf is actually the Smithsonian, which recently this summer, if you're familiar with this campaign, they actually crowdfunded an exhibition for the very first time at the Freer-Sackler Gallery. And this was on, you know, the visual, some of the visual elements surrounding yoga. And what was really cool, not only the fact that they crowdfunded it, and you can see that they're pretty close to their goal, they also created a program called Yoga Messengers. And these were people who could sign up for the program, and then they were equipped with all of these tools and suggestions on ways that they could share and promote the exhibition within their own networks. So this was everything from video links to email templates to suggestions on hosting benefit yoga classes to support the gallery. So again, it's about making it easy for people to take actions that will have the potential to influence others in their networks, and, you know, providing them even, you know, with the messages and with the tools, in addition to kind of the motivation, inspiration piece. So my final piece of advice is really about closing the loop. And this is so important and I think so often overlooked. You know, we know that people are skeptical about whether or not they're having an impact using social media. You can see that it lags some of the more traditional forms of engagement, like giving money or volunteering in person. So in order to encourage people to keep up with these, you know, influential online activities, you have to actually show them that it is having an impact and update them on what that impact is. You know, think about rewarding their efforts and recognizing them when they do share and when they do that type of behavior that, you know, you want to see, the same way that you might reward donors or volunteers in the more traditional sense. Donorschoose.org is a great example, and it's a terrific organization. They're really good at updating progress on the different projects that people can fund through their site. If you're familiar with them, they are an organization that allows people to contribute to school projects around the country. So if you have a third grade classroom in Baltimore that needs new equipment for its science laboratory, individuals can, you know, basically crowdfund those campaigns and contribute small amounts. And so they're really great about reporting back on the impact. You know, they ask people to share with their networks, and then they report back with the results to show how those shares and how that, you know, engagement contributed to this larger effort, and that, you know, projects ultimately ended up getting funded. Another organization that's, you know, really good at this, and this is kind of an off-sited one, so Charity Water is really excellent at reporting back on impact. They're actually really excellent at quite a few things, but I love this example. They always, when you host a fundraiser on behalf of Charity Water, they'll always send you this personalized impact report, and it, you know, shows you, you know, even where the well that they funded is being built. So in this particular case, a supporter who also happened to be a graphic designer took the impact data that he was emailed, and he turned it into this really cool infographic, which Charity Water then turned around and shared with all of its fans to kind of recognize and reward that extra effort that he put in. So it's a great example of how rewarding and encouraging people by, you know, reporting impact can actually come back around in terms of then having more engagement and more content that you can utilize. And finally, because I always like to share examples that are on a slightly smaller scale, because, you know, let's be honest, not everyone has a Charity Water budget or, you know, the digital team to make this work. This is an example that actually comes from within our own Georgetown alumni community. This is an alumna of the Master's Program in Public Relations and Corporate Communications, and she's now the executive director of a really fantastic local nonprofit here in DC called Young Playwrights Theater. And a couple years ago, they had a campaign goal to raise $50,000 during the month of December. And so they created this Get 15 to Give 15 fundraising challenge, they called it. And basically, it was encouraging everyone connected to the organization, staff, friends, family, volunteers, folks who'd engaged with the organization before, to ask 15 people in their network to give $15. And so they created, fun content. They did comparisons. You could spend $15 on a Snuggie, or you could give $15 to Young Playwrights. And they had these, really nice email templates that people could customize and include their, personal story and, easily send it out to people in their networks. And they were successful. And, what's really cool is they hit their campaign goal. They raised the money that they wanted to. And it really sort of started to transform the internal culture of the organization to one in which, everybody connected to the organization really feels empowered to use their influence on behalf of the organization. And I should mention that one of the really cool things was that the prize in this contest was having one of the young playwrights write a play about the person who got the most donors. And so you can see that they closed the loop. They reported back, yes, we hit our goal, and, here's the winner, and she's going to have a play written about her life. So I think it's a great example of kind of all of the things that we've just been talking about. So the big takeaways here, I think, whether you work for an organization or if you want to start a campaign on your own to support a cause using social media, I think there are a few kind of key things to remember. One is to make the case by creating content that resonates with people. Think stories and videos and photos. The second is to make sure that you really personalize it, since we know that people give to other people. They don't give to faceless organizations or large groups of people that they don't know. They give to people. And third, ask them to do something concrete, whether that's donate or it's share or upload your own story, et cetera. I think back to one of the biggest lessons that I learned way back when I was in my pre-Georgetown days when I made my living as a recording artist, believe it or not. Very early on in my career, I couldn't figure out why no one was coming to my shows. I was doing everything right. I thought I had a cool website. I put up flyers around town. I wrote good music. But what I didn't realize at the time, and what I learned, quite quickly after that, is that when you're first starting out and no one knows you, the only people who care enough to come are your friends and your family. And that's because they care about you, and it's you that they want to support. So you have to ask them first. And I think the same principle applies here. If you want people to support the causes that you support, then you have to attach your influence to it and make it about supporting you. And then, those proverbial empty rooms will fill with people once it's you that they're supporting. So that is it for my slides, and hopefully we have lots of time for questions. So I'd love to open it up to discussion and answer any questions that you have.
Okay, great. Well, Julie, thank you so much for all of that, and I also encourage everyone to take your time and submit some questions because we do have time. But the first one, do we have a sense of what is the tipping point of moving from raising awareness to behavior change, how many impressions, et cetera? Is there a way you can put a number on that?
That's a great question, and I think it really depends on the organization or the size of the campaign specifically. I don't think there's a magic number where a certain number of impressions yields this certain number of actions. And I think it also depends on really sort of the strength of the call to action and do you have a really tangible thing for people to do? Because in that case, you could get a much higher percentage of people who are actually taking that step that you want them to take. So I think it depends on a lot of different factors, and there's no real sort of magic number that, if you reach a million people seeing it, then, you're guaranteed to get 1,000 who are, actively engaged.
Mm-hmm. And we have a question here about your research. Is the new research you referenced available on the CSIC site?
It is, absolutely, yeah. And I can also build that link into the slides, when I send them to you and when you send them out to everybody. But, yeah, if you go to our website, csic.georgetown.edu. The most recent study is called Digital Persuasion, And that's the one that has a lot of the stuff specifically on influence. And the one that's from 2 years ago, which I think still has a lot of really interesting tidbits and information that holds up, that one was called The Dynamics of Cause Engagement, and they're both up there.
Okay, great. And sometimes causes are so specific it can be hard to engage with a big audience. Other than asking your close network of family and friends to support, do you have any other suggestions as to how to get the cause to relate to individuals that might not be close to it?
I'm jotting down notes just to make sure that I remember that. So aside from the personal connection, I mean, really that's the biggest thing that we see in the research. It's the personal connection. We've even compared that back to, you know, well, what if a celebrity supports it? Or that was probably, I would say that's probably the sixth or seventh thing down on the list. Other things are, you know, sort of the perception of the scale of the issue that ranked a little bit higher, I think. You know, if it's you know, a very localized issue versus one that impacts a broad number of people, then you'll see people more inclined to engage with it, which is, it's interesting because it's like, in theory, people are more inclined to support something that impacts a lot of people, but when it comes to actually, you know, donating, they want to know the specific person who's going to be affected by, you know, their engagement. So it's sort of an interesting, you know, dichotomy, I guess. In terms of other ways to, you know, make it relate back to the individual, I mean, I think the other thing really is so the story piece. So even if you don't have that personal connection, if you can frame out a compelling story about the work that the organization does in terms of what they call, you know, universal wants and needs. So picture, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and there's different, you know, things that are universal kind of human conditions, things that we can all relate to. If you can really craft, you know, a compelling story about the work that you do and the impact that you have and how it meets these needs, then that, I think, can spur that connection that, so even if you don't know somebody who is personally affected by it, just that human-to-human connection will make that more likely to happen. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. And sort of a follow-up question to that, we have someone here that works with many groups that vary from high school clubs to larger companies. So how can this person make their communal mission clear? It's a nonprofit she's working for. The communal mission clear and bring all these various groups together online. So groups that might not have anything in common with one another but care about the same mission.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that gets back to, you know, do you want to, well, first of all, the question is, do you want all of those audiences engaging with you on the same channel, or do you have sort of different channels that you would use for different audiences? And there's, you can sort of go both ways with it, knowing that, you know, the more targeted your message, the more likely you are to get somebody to engage with it. So I don't know if you want to have, if you want to be, you know, directing everybody, whether they're a, you know, a high school student or a corporate partner or something like that, if you want them all to be engaging with you in the same way on the same platform. You know, I've seen organizations, particularly, you know, education organizations that maybe do have an active population of students or, you know, recent alums, you know, maybe they have a separate Facebook group or they have a separate, you know, Twitter profile for alums. I mean, and just look at Georgetown. I mean, there are so many different, you know, profiles and different platforms that engage with, you know, similar populations but in different ways. So I think one way of doing that is to kind of encourage them to engage with you on different channels, and that way you make sure that the content that you're giving them is tailored specifically to what their needs are.
All right. And what organizations do you recommend for practical classes on how to build an effective social media presence, other than the Georgetown School of Continuing Studies, of course?
Other than us, yeah. So I actually think there's a few options. There's a lot of information available for free online. You know, if you Google nonprofit social media, there's tons of bloggers in this space who are fantastic, you know, sources of information on this. There's, you know, Beth Cantor. There's a woman named Kivi LaRue Miller, I think is her name. She's written a couple books on it. So, you know, there's all these kind of thought leaders who are out there, you know, putting out great free content, you know, every single day of the week. There are other organizations. There's one called NTEN, that's sort of the professional association for nonprofit technology folks, and they do a lot. They have an excellent conference every year that has a lot of really fantastic sessions. I think, you know, conferences are a big way to get a lot of this information as well, in addition to, you know, great networking opportunities. And all of the big conferences now will include, digital and social media is a big part of that. And they'll have, you know, everything from social media 101, how to set up your profile, all the way up to, you know, some of the more sophisticated things, measuring and monitoring. How do we know if this is working? The Association of Fundraising Professionals, I know, does a lot with digital. Some of the other big kind of nonprofit trade associations are doing a lot with digital. So I think conferences, professional associations, if you just do some Googling, you'll find all kinds of tips and strategies. There are, workshops and things like that that centers like ours and, you know, educational programs offer. You can do, you know, a half-day session, or you can, you know, sign up for a webinar or something like that. So there's lots of information. Another one is lynda.com, lynda.com. Has a lot of information on how to use different platforms and, you know, how do you use Google Analytics or set up search engine optimization, things like that. And those are, actually I think they're free if you're part of the current student population at Georgetown. And then you can sign up for the service otherwise.
Great. All right, perfect. And that, sorry, I was looking up lynda.com right now.
Yeah.
much of the focus today has been on Facebook and Twitter. Are there other suggestions you may have for LinkedIn, which is perhaps more restrained in terms of philanthropic content by its very nature? And also now they've changed things, so there's a promotions tab and all those things they can read out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. LinkedIn is one that I think is continuing to try to figure out sort of where it fits. What it does really well is it's that professional, networking piece. And so organizations who are maybe, membership associations or, sort of have that networking professional development component, I think would be really well served to, start a group on LinkedIn or something like that as a way to kind of connect memberships and to help fulfill kind of that professional development piece of their missions. Other than that, I've seen, nonprofits, you can kind of claim your company page on there and you can post status updates and, people can like them and comment on them and things like that, but I don't see it being as much of a huge part of, your social media strategy right now as, some of the other platforms are.
Okay, and do you see, some people are talking about the fact that Facebook is dying out a little bit. Do you believe that? Do you think, I know that even when I'm talking with my student interns, they are all about Instagram and don't use Facebook at all, so do you have to switch it up depending on the demographic, the age of the target audience for your cause? And do you see a future medium that we should really be paying attention to?
That's another great question, yes. So a couple of things. I tend to not think that it's dying out as much as, there was an article, I think, in Huffington Post or a couple of blogs lately that made the rounds that was, supposedly a 13-year-old girl who wrote it and said, I don't use Facebook anymore and none of my friends do. I think the interesting thing for causes and for nonprofits is, like you said, you really have to go where your supporters are. So right now, what's interesting is that the biggest growth areas of Facebook are, baby boomers and older, some of the older demographics who incidentally also happen to make up probably a large percentage of the active donor base or the supporter base for organizations. So I think it's definitely too soon for organizations to jump ship on Facebook. That being said, they may want to think about if they do have that younger demographic as a population that they want to engage, to think about switching it up and maybe focusing for those people in particular. Interestingly enough, they may not be considered donors yet, but you may want to think about, using Instagram or some of the other platforms. So really kind of figure out where the people are and what you want them to do. And that will kind of inform which channels, you choose to be on. And as far as like the next biggest thing, I think because the visual piece continues to grow so much, I think, things like Instagram will continue to to really be popular. I think organizations are still kind of trying to figure out what to do with Instagram, especially now that you've got the video component as well, and that's, you know, we've seen videos are huge and a huge way to, you know, tell the story of your organization if you can get it into 15 seconds. You know, Pinterest is interesting, but again, really great visual content, but I don't know that, you know, most nonprofits, I think, haven't really had much success with it, and they're really trying to figure out, well, what do we want to do with this platform? You know, what do we want people to do after they pin or like one of our photos? And what now? Like, what do we do next? I think it's a lot more successful with, you know, retailers or people who can drive people back to buying products after that. So I think, you know, the visual piece, you know, any platform that continues to capitalize on that visual piece will be sort of the leader of the pack in the future. That being said, you know, Facebook just keeps incorporating all of the features of other ones, you know, as they become popular, it just sort of sucks them all up and incorporates them into their algorithms and into the things that they do. So I don't see them going away, you know, anytime soon or not being one to be concerned with.
All right. And that's great. And as far as reporting that goes, since that is so important, if I, you know, I'm a nonprofit, I don't have a lot of resources, and I'm just starting from the beginning on trying to report back my engagement and impact. Are there tools you recommend for the starting point, or maybe 2.0 tools for people who have got this down a little bit?
Sure. I mean, a couple things. So one, you can always report impact. You know, you could always report it through a story or through an anecdote or something like that. You know, that's just as, you know, just as meaningful, just as engaging as being able to come back and say, you know, we raised X amount of dollars or something like that. The other thing is, I think, you know, if you can put in place some tracking, you know, you can see, get in there in Google Analytics and look around a little bit, maybe build out a spreadsheet and track over time, you know, this is the amount of traffic to our website, to our donate page that's coming from Facebook. You know, I think it's really cool to report back on those kinds of statistics, especially when you think about some of these online one-day fundraising competitions that are, you know, becoming really popular now, and different cities have their own kind of one-day fundraising competition where all of the local organizations participate, and, you know, there's a leaderboard and people can compete to, you know, who has the most donors and things like that. What I think is really cool and an opportunity for organizations to report about impact, it's not just at the end of the day the total number of dollars that were raised, but you can actually say, hey, you know, in our community this was shared this number of times and it generated, you know, this 150% boost in our traffic. And those are things that you can, you know, track pretty easily. And those are pretty cool to be able to attribute that back to your community. And you know, as somebody who uses social media and who would, you know, participate in something like that, I would love to see that. You know, love for the organization to say, you know, this is the type of conversation and, you know, buzz and engagement that we were able to generate because of you. So I think it can be, you know, it can be a story, it can be an anecdote if you don't have really, you know, sophisticated measurement tools in place. And then it can also be thinking past just you know, reporting back on the dollars raised, but really kind of quantifying that engagement and even reporting back on that.
All right, great. And sorry, back to Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Which of the three sites do you think are the most successful and sustainable, in your opinion, and this is for benchmarking purposes?
Sure, that's a good question. For the successful one, it's kind of a loaded question because it depends on how do you define success? So, you know, what are your goals? Do you want to be, you know, do you want to be a thought leader? Do you want to be connecting with other sort of like-minded partners? In that case, you know, you might want to go the Twitter route, and that might be a better tool for you because it's more about generating that conversation and being able to demonstrate that, you know, you're a go-to source for news or information around a particular topic. You know, that's kind of how people expect to be engaged with on Twitter, you know, to be that source of information, to be taken away to, you know, other links and other places. Whereas, you know, you may have other, you know, if your goal is to have a place to kind of host a dialogue or a conversation and get people to chime in and be a part of an engaged community, then you may want to focus more on Facebook, where you can kind of host that dialogue on your own page. And, you know, with Facebook as opposed to Twitter, people expect to remain in that platform and to complete all of their activities within that, which Facebook loves, and that's why they keep layering all those features so that they can charge advertisers more for the time that people spend actually on the platform itself. So I think how you would determine success depends on, you know, what your goals are and what you want to get out of those particular platforms. So for some organizations, it may make more sense to pull your resources into, you know, just focusing on Twitter. And for some, you know, you may decide, you know, Twitter really isn't helping us at all. It's not really where we need to be. And so you can put your resources into Facebook. It's totally okay to not have one, not have something on every platform. If, to your point, and this is so key, if you can't sustain it. And so you also kind of have to think about, you know, what is our definition of sustainability? How often do we want to post? Because as we know, you know, social media, technically the platforms are free, but they're certainly not free in terms of the time that it takes to build that credible presence and to maintain and to find the sources of content and, you know, whether that's creating it or, you know, going out and curating and finding cool links to share. It takes time. And so, you know, certainly when you're thinking about which platforms you can sustain, you know, think about, well, maybe it doesn't make sense for us to be on everything, and maybe it makes more sense to really focus on, you know, Facebook, where we have a plan in place. We know we're going to post this type of content every Monday, and then we're going to post this type of content every Thursday. The other thing I should say, too, in terms of, you know, bandwidth and how to sustain it is the time that it takes to monitor. And this is important on, you know, every channel, but, you know, people really, if they take the time to comment or, you know, to interact with your page, then organizations really need to take the time to comment back or to, you know, to thank them in some way. And the way that you'll know that that happens is when you're, you know, you're listening and you're monitoring the conversation. And, you know, on Twitter, you know, if your organization gets mentioned or people retweet or something, it's always nice to be you know, generous and to acknowledge that and to encourage that type of behavior. And that in itself takes additional bandwidth, so it's not just looking for content, creating content, it's also monitoring and looking for opportunities to engage back with people.
Okay, great. And I am going to do a plug right now for Georgetown alumni, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. We are at Georgetown ECS on Facebook. You can find us under Georgetown University Alumni and on LinkedIn, so I'll do a plug for that as well. But Julie, last question, since I know we are almost at time. A lot of people talk about on social media how you have to find your voice, and I'm sure you went through that as well when you first started off going online. So do you have tips for really trying to find your voice and sounding authentic on the internet?
Yeah, that is a great question. And I think some of the tips about experimenting, it certainly comes into play here as well. You know, I think organizations have a tendency, I know in higher ed especially, we have a tendency to be very, you know, very reserved and, you know, almost kind of strip some of the personality out of the stuff that you post. But people want to, they want to know that there's a human being, you know, behind that Facebook page, behind that Twitter account. So it's okay to be, you know, to loosen up a little bit and to have some fun, you know, post lighthearted content. And certainly this depends on the type of organization. But I think most organizations can, you know, be more conversational on these platforms and, you know, be, like you said, you know, that authenticity really comes from having a human voice behind it, not just this institutional advice, this institutional voice. And I think a lot of that can be accomplished as well in the engagement piece. So if somebody comments to you, you know, I saw a statistic that like 95% of pages, like brand pages on Facebook, don't respond back. And so that's just a way right off the bat to prove that there's a human being who's listening on the other side is to comment back and say, you know, thank you, I appreciate the share, or I appreciate the retweet, or, you know, thanks for giving us a follow Friday. And, you know, just being sort of a genuinely kind and, you know, a value-added member of the community, I think that goes a long way towards establishing that authentic voice. You know, remember that you're, you know, you are a person posting that content, and it's people on the other end that are receiving it, so they want to have that sort of, you know, again, that human interaction.
All right, great. Well, Julie, thank you so much. We are right at 1:30. Thank you so much for your time today. And everyone, I do encourage you to check out Julie and Alumni Career Services online. Best of luck with your causes, and I hope to see you on future webinars. Again, this webinar will be available on our YouTube channel, and I will email everyone a copy of the slides.
Great, thank you.